Six Filipino human trafficking victims rescued in Myanmar have returned home. This is the latest batch of repatriated Filipinos who were lured online with a promise of employment in Thailand, only to work at a Chinese cryptocurrency scam in Myanmar. Some of the victims were allegedly tortured if they weren't able to make a profit. They were also forced to pay up to 300,000 pesos to gain their freedom.
Nung una po talaga, pagdating namin doon, nagba-back out na po agad kami. Kaso po, sinisingil po kami nung una ng 3,000 US dollar, USDT. Eh wala naman po kaming ganung kalaking pera. Paglapag namin ng Bangkok, ang sabi, kasikasuhin daw po yung working visa namin. Nung nakapag-cross namin ng river, doon na lang din po namin nalaman na nasa Myanmar na din po kami.
Nung nagtatanong na po sila na kailangan na pong magpadala ng pamilya ng pera, sa akin pong side kasi wala nga pong naipadala, konti lamang po. So kada ano po, nung una po, unang araw, napalo na po ako ng tubo sa ulo, sa iba't ibang parte ng katawan at saka sa likod ko po sa may puwitan po.
Some 60 more Filipino human trafficking victims remain in Myanmar, according to the Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission. Philippine officials are now coordinating with authorities of concerned countries to crack down on the scammers. The Philippine Migrant Workers Department teams up with the Foreign Affairs Department to rescue more Filipinos who fled conflict-torn Sudan. The DMW says a composite team between the two agencies is now on its way to Port Sudan to help around 100 Filipinos there reach safe grounds in Saudi Arabia. The agency is calling on Filipinos who remain in the war-torn country to evacuate. The government earlier said at least 50 Filipinos remain in Sudan, while hundreds have returned to the Philippines.
Patuloy ang panawagan ng ating pamahalaan na sila'y lumikas na kasi ito ay issue ng safety and security. Hindi po ito ang panahon, na pag-isipan ang mga ilang bagay pa na hindi na sasangkot ang safety and security. Kaligtasan po ng buhay ang usapan, kaya nananawagan po tayo sa mga naroroon pa sa Khartoum, sa Sudan, na lumikas na ho dahil nakahanda pong tumulong ang inyong pamahalaan.
Well, another attempt at a truce in Sudan fails as airstrikes and artillery pounded the capital, Khartoum, Friday. Despite committing to protect civilians and allow humanitarian access, Sudan's forces and the paramilitary group RSF have shown little sign they are ready to end the deadly fighting. But a Sudanese envoy says it isn't the Sudan army that's launching offensives.
The Sudanese armed forces are not launching an offensive. They are actually making a defensive. This is why they will not open fire only if they have been attacked. And this is why from time to time there will be a kind of what apparently may be as a breach of the ceasefire. But actually this is not meant. And this is actually not the case which is currently being on. There is actually a kind of trying to operationalize the center of the town. And as much as those rebellious regiments who took refuge into heavily inhabited areas and they confiscated houses, they are there. And this is why the army would not attack them, definitely, in order to lessen the loss of civilians. This is our principal commitment, actually, and we are abiding by it.
A so-called declaration of principles was signed in Saudi Arabia late on Thursday after nearly a week of talks between the warring factions. This is seen as the first step to the start of negotiations to end the fighting. Philippine officials heading to Kuwait next week to discuss an entry ban imposed on Filipinos without residency permits. The delegation will be composed of officials from the Departments of Migrant Workers and Foreign Affairs. They will clarify a supposed violation committed by the Philippine government in its labor agreement with Kuwait.
Merong tayong impormasyon na kailangan pong meron pong napipintong pag-uusap sa susunod na linggo ang magbigay ng daan sa labor diplomacy na tinatawag pag-uusap sa pagitan ng pamahalang Pilipinas at pamahalang Kuwait, may delegation po, combined delegation, whole of government approach, DFA at ang DMW magtutungo sa Kuwait. Kasi kailangan natin din klaruhin ano yung rationale, ano yung dahilan, ano yung mga issues na bumabalot dito sa suspension, at para malaman din natin kung ano ang mga posibleng solusyon, magpagbibigay daan no? Sa pakikipag-usap, pagkaklaro, at sabay nito, solusyon para magkaroon ng positibo tayong pagtugon at solusyon dito sa mga issues.
According to estimates of local recruitment agencies, some 3,000 Filipinos are affected by the ban. Government vows to provide assistance.
Of course, ang mahalagang direktiba ni Secretary Tuts Ople ay tulungan yung mga apektado at yung mga posibleng maapektuhan itong pagpataw ng suspension. So, nakabobilize po ang National Reintegration Center na nasa ilalim ng Department of Migrant Workers at ang Overseas Workers Welfare Administration under Administrator Arnel Ignacio, nakahanda pong tumulong at meron na nga pong natutulungan tayo sa kasalukuyan.
Kuwait announced the sweeping entry ban Wednesday. There have been reports the Kuwaiti government may have suspended the issuance of visas to Filipinos due to the presence of the country's resource shelter there. Let's get more details from our correspondent Job Manahan. Job, what's the latest?
Rica, that's right. Paul Cortez, an assistant secretary at the Migrant Affairs Office of the Department of Foreign Affairs, said the presence of Manila's migrant workers and other overseas Filipinos resource center there may have been the reason behind the move of the Arab state. Cortez was citing news reports from Kuwait newspapers when he made a statement to the media and clarified that this is not yet the official stance of the Kuwaiti government. The official insisted, however, the Philippines did not violate any provisions of its bilateral agreement with Kuwait because these resource centers were in accordance of the country's laws. He added that a 2018 agreement between the Philippines and Kuwait had listed provisions, making it clear that the country would operate a shelter for overseas Filipinos staying there. This is the reason Cortez said that he's still questioning why this is considered a violation of a labor agreement with the Arab state. To clarify this, he said the Department of Migrant Workers and the Department of Foreign Affairs will go to Kuwait in the coming days to talk to the Kuwaiti government. At present, they are coordinating with the Migrant Workers Department to discuss how they could help Filipinos trying to go to the Middle Eastern country and find out what assistance they need. Rica.
Thank you so much. Job Manahan reporting live. Former Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan now out on bail. Khan has been detained since May 9 on corruption charges, but the country's Supreme Court on Thursday declared his arrest illegal. Khan's arrest had led to violent protests in Pakistan, which left at least 10 people dead. The city of El Paso in Texas preparing for the worst after COVID-era border rules expired. Hundreds of migrants slept along the border fence with hopes of being able to enter the U.S. But the so-called Title 42 policy has been replaced with another immigration law, which carries strict penalties for illegal migrants, rather, including 5- and 10-year bans on re-entry for those deported.
We'll continue to make sure that our asylum seekers and also the city of El Paso continues to be our priorities. We have opened up our two shelters, but one of them right now is in operation. And we have about 150 asylum seekers that have been put in there. They are families only, and single males and single females have gone to hotels at this point. We still need to prepare for the unknown because we don't know what's going to happen next week and continue to happen day in and day out. We are continuing to work really close with the Border Patrol.
As the Title 42 policy ends, migrants can request for asylum through a new mobile app called CBP1, an acronym of Customs and Border Patrol. But some asylum seekers complain about difficulties in setting appointments on the app. This as the U.S. Border Patrol limits appointments to only 1,000 per day, prioritizing those who have waited the longest.
So even though Title 42 is over, it was replaced by this new rule, which really restricts asylum eligibility. There are a few different ports of entry here in the Tijuana area where individuals could have the opportunity to get in line to try to seek protection in the United States. But right now, the vast majority of people that are able to exercise that right have to go through this smartphone app known as CBP1, and they're only passing out really a limited number of these per day.
Elon Musk has made his pick for his replacement as Twitter CEO. And the rumors were true. The tech billionaire has chosen top ad executive Linda Yaccarino. Yaccarino stepped down from NBC Universal effective immediately on Friday following the reports. Musk's move is said to allay the growing concerns of Tesla investors on the time that Musk is devoting to turning around Twitter.